Thank you very much, Francisca. First of all, I want to say that, if you hear me, yes, I want to say that it was a very long but interesting first meeting of Minister of Justice of the European Union during the Portuguese presidency. And I would like to thank the presidency and notably,
do you have?
Yes. And notably you, Francisca, for your commitment to advance the important files on the agenda of today's meeting. Firstly, I want to insist on the fact it was an opportunity for me to underline the importance of getting the Urban Public Prosecutor Office up and running. The Commission wants to see this in the first half of this year. In the December meeting of Justice Ministers, I urge Member States to speed up the process, in particular the nomination of the European Delegate Prosecutors and the implementation of the necessary legislation. But the recovery of our economies will largely depend on the measures funded by the Next Generation EU recovery instruments of 750 billion in addition to the long-term EU budget agreed in December of 1,074.3 billion. But it is crucial this money is well spent and protected against fraud. I want to say that we really now need to have a fully functioning EPPO. I'm sure that in the next weeks we will be ready with around 15 member states, but we need to have all the 22 participating member states on board. And it's very important, of course, for the beginning of the operation of the EPPO. Then about the three sessions of today. The first one, this morning, we had a discussion on one of the presidency's main priorities, the legal protection of vulnerable adults. This was an important discussion to hold at a time when the European population is aging. In 2019, more than a fifth of the EU 27 population was 65 and over. It is why the Commission adopted a specific paper on aging this week. It was also an important discussion to hold in the midst of a health crisis disproportionately affecting the oldest and most vulnerable citizens. The European Commission is committed to ensuring that judicial protection in the EU is harmonized and afforded to every citizen in the Union, including, of course, the most vulnerable. With regard to civil law, the Commission is strongly in favor of the ratification of the 2000 Hague Adults Convention, which protects vulnerable adults who are not in a position to protect their interests. Without this convention, the reality is that vulnerable adults moving to another member state or owning assets in another member state still face a large number of legal difficulties, lengthy judicial proceedings, and possible abuses. Only 10 member states have signed it so far. It is not good enough. It is why my services have launched a legal study to address the outstanding obstacles for full ratification and the adoption of EU legislation to complement this instrument. In addition to the legal study around the Hague Convention, the Commission is also launching a study to analyze the current legal situation and issues arising in cross-border judicial cooperation. I also made the point that vulnerable adults, victims of crime, also require specific support. This is something the Commission underlined in the first EU-wide victim rights strategy adopted last year. This strategy deals with all victims of all crimes, but it pays special attention to the most vulnerable victims of crime, including the elderly. Under the strategy, the Commission will evaluate the current EU legislation on victim rights. This will mean further discussions with justice ministers and other stakeholders over the next 2 years, and if necessary, the Commission will propose legislative changes at the end of this reflection period by 2022. Today's discussion was good input for this process, but we need to keep this going and I'm pleased to see this is such a prominent place on the Portuguese presidency's agenda. Following this first session, I was joined by Commissioner Ylva Johansson for the discussions on the threat posed by counterfeit products. Almost every sector is affected, from pesticides to airplane parts. It is why there is a current discussion about having common minimum rules for counterfeiting offences at EU level. We are not yet there, though. What is more pressing in the midst of a health pandemic is the increasing number of counterfeit medical products on the market. In a Europol operation last year, almost 33 million COVID-19 related counterfeit medical devices were seized, including face masks, tests, and diagnosis kits. A total of 8 tons of raw materials, chemicals, and antiviral drugs were seized. Cross-border cooperation here is extremely important, and why the Commission strongly supports the signature and ratification, like it was said by Franziska van Dunham, of the Council of Europe Medicrime Convention by all EU member states. The fight against counterfeiting also requires specialized knowledge, networks, and cooperation tools, including Eurojust, which helped national judicial authorities to tackle serious cross-border crimes. Part of fighting against counterfeit products is also about breaking down organized criminal networks. Together with my colleague Ylva Johansson, we intervene to inform ministers that this will be addressed in the upcoming EU agenda on organized crime, which we plan to adopt under the Portuguese presidency. And then, as a third session, we also held a very timely discussion on the digitalization of justice. This is an area where it is clear that there are big differences between member states. I reminded the ministers of justice that they should prioritize in their national recovery plans the digitalization of their justice administration and courts. The funding opportunities offered under the Recovery and Resilience Facility represent a unique opportunity that they should seize. 20% of the overall funding is earmarked for digitalization. Justice is one of the key priorities. So I stress that all member states should take advantage of this major EU support mechanism. As you know, last month, the Commission adopted a communication setting out measures to guide the digitalization of justice in the EU. And in this communication, we announced, and I repeat it again today, that the Commission will adopt a package of legislative measures to improve digital judicial cooperation by the end of this year. This is so important for criminal or terrorism investigation cases where exchanges between member states are time critical. The edge from electronic communication is clear. At the same time, it is important to ensure that digitalization is accessible for all involved in the justice system. For example, for disadvantaged court users who lack the means or skills to access a digital justice system. Special arrangements or training is required. Fundamental rights must be protected. This is very important in the development and deployment of artificial intelligence in justice systems. Artificial intelligence tools must respect fundamental rights and be governed by the principle of human centricity. This is work in progress, but important to monitor as it develops. The Commission will continue to do so as part of our annual Justice Core Board. I was very pleased to see that it was a clear commitment from all the Ministers of Justice in the European Union to invest more and more in the digital tools. And I want to thank again the Portuguese presidency after the German presidency to put such an issue on a very high level in the priority in the presidential program. And thanks, Franziska, for such a commitment to go further with a new investment in digital tools and new developments in such a digital transition for the justice systems.
Thank you. We now have time for a few questions. Unfortunately, very limited time. We'll start with a question from the room. But first, let me just remind all the journalists who are online following this press conference, if you wish to pose a question, please raise your hand in the on the platform so that we know. Thank you. We'll start with RTP here.